Firing Line with William F. Buckley, Jr. Tonight's guest, Floyd McKissick, Executive Director of the Congress of Racial Equality. Our topic, Civil Rights and Foreign Policy.
Mr. Floyd McKissick is the National Director of CORE, the Congress of Racial Equality. He is by training a lawyer, a graduate of the law school at the University of North Carolina. He succeeded Mr. James Farmer last January, and it was generally understood that under his direction, CORE would enter into a more militant phase, which indeed it has done. Mr. McKissick has called Vice President Humphrey a man with, quote, racist views, has endorsed the notion of black power, has alienated such long-standing supporters of CORE as Ms. Lillian Smith, who believes that the organization has been taken over, in her words, by adventurers, nihilists, and haters, against which charges Mr. McKissick has frequently defended himself and his organization. But the subject we're here to discuss is the relationship of the civil rights movement to American foreign policy. Mr. McKissick, having long ago proceeded on the assumption that there is a nexus between the two which commits those who favor civil rights to taking a particular, he would say, harmonious position concerning foreign policy. Only a few weeks ago, for instance, Mr. McKissick went to Cambodia on a mission to ascertain whether the American Air Force is justified in bombing certain areas in Cambodia. His investigation completed, he informed the world that we have no right to bomb Cambodia because Cambodia is not, as alleged by the Pentagon, providing access to South Vietnam for men and supplies going to the Viet Cong. And then Mr. McKissick has urged all Negroes to defy the draft, promising to help them to do so successfully in any way he can. Mr. McKissick's interest in foreign policy goes back a long way, and I'd like to begin by asking him whether he now regrets his role in 1948 as an organizer for Youth for Wallace. Mr. McKissick.
No, but I'd like to correct one or two things that were said earlier. First of all, I think my statement was in regard to Negroes serving in the Army, and I think we picketed the recruiting station that we were urging every person not to volunteer. Now, I don't know how the story was actually reported. Now, to answer your specific charge, when I was a college student, I was an organizer for Henry Wallace. I supported the views of Henry Wallace and certainly do not regret having supported the views of Henry Wallace in my earlier years.
Would you acknowledge what seems to be rather universally acknowledged, that the Henry Wallace campaign was dominated by the Communist Party of the United States?
I would not acknowledge that. I would acknowledge that there might have been some communists in the party at that time. There were communists in the group.
So therefore,
I have since learned that. That's true, yes.
You would disagree then with the judgment on the matter. I think this is very important because we've got to get into the relationship of the communists on the civil rights movement and a number of other matters. Would you therefore say that, for instance, the editors of the New York Times, the Secretary of State under the Truman administration, Mr. Henry Wallace himself, the editors of the New Republic, in which Mr. Henry Wallace was serving at that moment, are wrong in their saying that the communists dominated the Wallace movement?
Quite an involved question, and while Mr. McKissick perhaps ponders the answer, we'll continue in just a moment.
I was asking you, Mr. McKissick, whether or not you in fact disagree with the relevant authorities on the matter of Henry Wallace's movement having been dominated by the communists.
First of all, I don't know what information that others had about Henry Wallace at the time that I was working in the campaign. I only knew that as a citizen, I had certain basic rights. I felt that Henry Wallace was a good man for the presidency, and I supported that campaign. Now, this is something else that always comes up. Who is a communist? What is a communist? To this very single day, no man has ever come to me and said, I am a communist. Will you join the Communist Party yet? So therefore, I really can't say with any degree of accuracy these authorities, they are authorities, could very well be correct. But for people presenting themselves to me as communists and saying that they are communists, I've never had that to happen yet.
Well, I haven't either. The communists don't usually go around doing that, you know.
I don't think so either.
But the reason this is relevant is because here, 18 years after Henry Wallace rose, after he ran for president, when you got everybody, not just conservatives, but liberals and Democrats and his own former associates and Henry Wallace himself, saying that, in fact, the Communist Party took over this operation. And here, in 1966, you as director of one of the largest civil rights organizations in the United States, still casting doubt on that, certainly invites a certain amount of skepticism about your own capacity to understand the effort to which communists undoubtedly are trying to utilize your movement, doesn't it, quite legitimately?
No, I think that we can make a mountain out of a molehill sometimes. I think it clearly indicates that the tendencies that I had early in life clearly prevailed throughout, and the same tendencies, the belief to freedom of expression, the belief to work for a candidate if you want to. I work just as hard for, say, a peace candidate now. I work just as hard for one that doesn't believe in war. I would work for a candidate of that type.
But don't you see, that's hardly the point. You might have worked for Lenin in 1917. The point is not whether you have the right
to back Henry Wallace.
The point is whether or not you're going to exercise the kind of prudence that will keep CORE from perhaps becoming what the Progressive Party in 1948 became, which was namely simply a pawn of the Soviet Union.
Well, I know a lot of people who worked in that campaign for Wallace who were not communists.
And of course, you weren't.
Yeah.
Obviously, there were many more people like you.
Obviously, there were many good people. I think to put a label on people, I've never been one who wanted to put a label on people because I think people don't think the way that you might think or really attach the significance to the things that you might deem important.
I don't follow you. Why can't I call you a Wallaceite if you were a Wallaceite and you're still glad that you were?
No.
Is that a label?
But you are not fair in saying because I supported Henry Wallace in 48. And I was associating with communists, that you now question my ability.
Mr. McKissick, I didn't say that, my friend.
You do raise it.
No. I didn't say whether, I didn't say that because you supported Henry Wallace, you were disqualified to pass on
the extent to which... You are saying am I not now flirting with communists today?
That's right. I was saying...
That's what you were saying.
If you do not now know what happened to the Wallace movement, then it seems to me that you have a special disqualification from evaluating what some people say is happening to SNCC, for instance, or perhaps even to CORE. If at this day and age, I don't mind you having voted for Wallace, so I think it was too bad, but I'm very much mind that you do not.
I
very much mind that you do not now know what it was that you did. I can understand somebody who voted for Adolf Hitler in 1932, but to defend it in 1933. Would, for me, have been utterly ununderstandable, let alone 18 years after Adolf Hitler came in. Now, my point is not that you voted for Henry Wallace, but that you continue to excuse yourself.
Let me ask you this. I was concerned primarily with Henry Wallace as a man. Was Henry Wallace a communist?
No, of course not.
All right, then. I associate with people like Jim Clark in Alabama, shake his hand, live in the same town, you see.
What's that got to do with it?
Well, that's the same thing. Guilt by association is what you say.
Jim Clark was not running for president of the United States.
Oh, but that's all right. He runs for sheriff of the county down in Alabama. And he's a very prominent man.
I don't really see the point, except that you keep an eclectic company. I'm simply saying that we're here to discuss tonight the interrelationship between the civil rights movement and communist foreign policy or American foreign policy.
What is foreign policy that's decided by an individual who happens not to be a communist? There are people who agree, who are not communists, for sure, who agree with a basic position, which may be a part of the same that the communists espouse.
Oh, there is no question about it.
Do you say that they are communists?
No, of course not. It's quite obvious, I think. And,
are we going back to McCarthy?
Wait, I was trying to answer your last question.
Okay.
It's quite obvious and plain that people differently motivated come to the same conclusion. Vito Marcantonio, when he was serving the communist cause in the Congress of the United States, voted the same way that Robert Taft did on a couple of issues.
Yeah.
And I think it would be very foolish to infer from that that Robert Taft was pro-communist. But what is not, I think, foolish
to
speculate
about
is
me,
whether
then?
Or not... Well, here's what I'm trying to infer. I'm trying to suggest that the Soviet Union and the communists are going to try to use every social movement, particularly those that appeal to idealistic people, for their own ends. And I'm asking whether or not you have shown by your experience and training that you know how to resist their manipulation of you for those ends. That's why I thought it highly pertinent to ask your opinions about the Henry Wallace experience.
Well, first of all, I think that I've learned a whole lot from being involved with the Henry Wallace Party in the first place. I've learned a lot about organization. I know a lot about organizing that I didn't know. And I know a lot of people attempt to use you in the position that you hold and the position that I hold now. And you can start from A and go through Z of the many people who will attempt to use you for various schemes. Mm-hmm. I think that one of the important things in the civil rights organization is that you have to take a position that's based upon principle and principle alone and stand on that principle.
I think that's the most important thing. Well,
now you can see, you can find ideologies and you can pick up the mail every day. And you can get mails and suggestions and innuendos and people who want to attach you to this cause and that cause and 51 causes. Mm-hmm. But certainly you have to certainly use your better judgment.
Well, but my point is, how good is your judgment, you see?
Well, I
think...
How round is an egg?
That's right. Well, not very. Your judgment is a matter of national concern. It really is.
Yes.
Your judgment is a matter of national concern, which is why so many people hope and pray that it will prove sufficient to keep the civil rights movement, or at least that part of it which you control, from deteriorating into simply another, in effect, pro-communist movement. And that's why when, for instance, you go to Cambodia, a lot of people think, oh my God, there's Floyd McKissick going to Cambodia. He's going to, in effect, be given a Potemkin tour of a few jungles and forests. Then he's going to meet the press. And then his picture's going to be shown all over the world. And the Pentagon becomes a liar, you see.
One tragic thing that I resent.
What?
And I resent the underlining. And I even resented the laughter that came forth from the audience here. And this is very serious to me. It's too long have people somewhat thought that black people were a little bit foolish.
Oh, cut it out, Mr. McKissick. You're not going to make this an anti-Negro show.
No, this is your favorite trick. This is no trick.
All right, am I treating you any different from the way I treat anybody else, or is this audience treating you different?
Let me tell you, I don't know. I'm not anybody else. I'm only Floyd McKissick.
I haven't seen anybody else.
But wait a minute.
If you think on my show you're going to construct this whole thing as an anti-Negro plot, you're going to have a hard time doing it, Mr. McKissick.
Well, I want to do is to have the opportunity to answer you.
Go ahead.
And if you would let me answer
without please imputing any kind of contempt by the audience
for you. No, you seem to think that I'm going to go to Cambodia and let somebody sell me a bill of goods.
I think you did.
And there were 11 people and the others were white.
So what does it have to do with the fact that you're colored?
No, you're wrong. You're wrong again. That's not the truth. It wasn't 11 people.
What, 9 people, 8 people?
Get your facts together now.
Get your facts.
I'm not going to tell you.
Are you anti-white?
That's not what I'm talking about.
All right, how many people were there?
Let me tell you one thing about the trip to Cambodia. We went to Cambodia simply because we wanted to know the truth about what was happening over there. And we didn't intend to go over there and let anybody sell us a bill of goods. And I really resent the inference that that I could be sold a bill of goods.
Well, you certainly were by Henry Wallace's movement.
No, I don't think Henry Wallace sold me a bill of goods.
Right,
and
so
I think
you...
that's a poor example that he sold me a bill of goods. I think he was a good man. And nobody can deny that Henry Wallace didn't serve this country very well.
I don't know a liberal.
And he wasn't an adequate man. Do you know the farmers right now plant that hybrid corn that he got on? I mean, let's get down to some of
that. That's like saying that Adolf Hitler was a good wallpaper hanger. We're not talking about what he did. we're talking about when he ran for president of the United States.
I don't think it's historically correct to put Henry Wallace in the campaign or put him on a comparison to Adolf Hitler. Wallace never committed the crimes or the atrocities that Hitler did.
I'm not saying anything about Henry Wallace in the first place that hasn't been said by liberals, that hasn't been said by the most left liberals. All you have to do is talk to people in the Liberal Party of New York, talk to people like Sidney Hook, a liberal anti-communist who despaired over the success that Henry Wallace had in fooling people like you into backing him. Now, you may say this is past history and we should forget about it, but I maintain it continues to be relevant when people succeed in getting you to go out to Cambodia, come back from Cambodia, and on the basis of what you saw with the evidence of your own eyes, you're willing in effect to call the President of the United States, the Secretary of State, the Defense Secretary of the United States liars. They tell you that they have positive evidence that Cambodia has been used as a supply route for certain parts of the economy. You say, no, it's not true. Now, don't you think some people are entitled to resent your insinuations about Mr. McNamara and Mr. Rusk and Mr. Johnson?
People are entitled to form any opinion that they want. But I'm going to call anybody a liar if I think that that person is a liar and I have the support to support such a statement. Then I'm going to say that.
I have no doubt you will.
Yeah.
The question, therefore, however, is not whether anybody has the power to control you from calling the President of the United States and his cabinet a lawyer, a liar.
Controlling me.
No. The question is, what should they think of you? What should people think of other people who arrive at opinions which, in the prevailing judgment, are utterly irresponsible and which have a way of playing into the hands of the communists?
Now, let's don't throw that irresponsible word in, because here's one mistake that's always been made. I've got a right to go to Cambodia and see if I want to what's going on over there as an individual, as head of an organization.
Who questioned it?
Yeah.
Who
questioned it? And I've got a right to form an opinion and express that opinion. But that opinion doesn't have to. See, this is one thing I criticize. Everybody thinks that a Negro leader has got to be 100% right. Black people don't have the right to even be wrong in this country.
That's because
and we must follow what everybody else does.
This is sheer paranoia for you to make this a Negro discussion.
No.
I would say exactly what I've just finished saying
you were the one who inserted this into the argument when you said that there were about 10 others and you were the only Negro to go and then you came back. If you hadn't put that part in, maybe I wouldn't have got on this kick.
Well, as I understood it, I was trying to detach the Negro question from the question
of
gullibility.
Don't you believe that if a group went,
from the
it
question
ought to
of
have
gullibility.
Been an integrated group?
If I may say so, now you may consider this inverse racism. I happen to think that the Negro people in the 20th century have shown a higher degree of political intelligence and resistance to the communist movement than people of my own faith.
You know, I really didn't know that you knew that.
Well, it's obvious. There was a tremendous effort made by the communists, by Paul Robeson, for instance,
and
to cultivate Negro support in the
30s. How many did they actually get?
Practically none. I say they have a superb record. Mm-hmm. But I would like, if I may, to proceed on the assumption that this isn't a question about Negroes. It's a question that has to do with your reliability, with the kind of public confidence that you can commandeer as somebody who is the head of the second most important civil rights group in the United States. Mm-hmm. And I'm suggesting that it's quite different for somebody to say that you don't have the right to go to Cambodia or to make an opinion. You have all those rights in the world, but I also have a right, and other people have a right,
to criticize,
to decide whether or not you know anything about the true nexus between civil rights and foreign policy. And this is what I think we ought to get into.
All right, well, suppose we get into it the way that you want to get into it.
All right, sir.
Before we get into this, Mr. Buckley, may we interrupt for just a moment for this message?
Well, let me ask you then, Mr. McKissick, how do you relate the civil rights movement to American foreign policy? That is to say, in your own words, why should somebody who is interested in civil rights for Negroes adopt your position on foreign policy?
Well, first of all, I don't see civil rights as a separate issue from foreign policy. I think if we concede at the outset that black and white people are all citizens of this country and should share in its responsibilities and should share in lines of policy making decisions throughout the mechanisms of the democratic process, that certainly black men have not participated in foreign policy heretofore. It might well have been that had we participated in foreign policy earlier, that we might have demonstrated when certain monies were being spent for war, when we were opposed, when we now find ourselves opposed to the war, we might have felt that we know for sure that any time a war comes, priority is given to the war rather than to a domestic problem. And that decisions regarding the spending of money are all made at Washington. Foreign policy decisions are all made in Washington. The questions of job, housing, education, these decisions affecting the nation are all made in Washington. And one decision in bears a relationship to the other decision. Because if we decide that we are going to fight a war, and we don't, and we got another issue, say universal military training, which we did not accept, our country will not accept. Universal military training, of course, left it to the selective service boards to put people into the army to fight the war, and of course, it always affects those who are poor. Even those who are poor and can't make it in civilian life volunteer into the armed services. Otherwise, the drafting can be very discriminatory, as we found in many southern localities where many black boys are drafted and white kids are exempted if they are in school. And of course, we have more black kids who don't go to school because they're unable to go to school, so therefore we make up a large part. I think it was there are varying statistics, about four sources of statistics now. But at any rate, the latest source, I think, showed us that it's now since 1954 through 1962 that the number of black combat troops have risen to about 35%. In the army. And it's basically because of the situation at home. A number of these kids are kids who have volunteered because they simply couldn't make it, couldn't get a job, couldn't get an education. So they join the army as a means of making it.
Mr. McKissick, may I ask you a couple of questions, because you have covered so many points.
I have.
But maybe we better touch on this last one and then and go back to the very interesting and fundamental point you made before. You say there are several series of statistics. I have the statistics as of this morning, gotten from the Pentagon, and the figures are that 14.7% of our combat troops in the Army are Negroes, not 35%, mm-hmm. And that in the Marines 8.9% are Negroes, mm-hmm. And that if you lump all the figures together, Navy, Air Force, Marines, and Army, and you take the fatalities, you find that the Negroes during the last 5 years in Vietnam have registered 14.6% of the fatalities, which is only just a little bit in excess of the population. But it's also true that apparently Southern whites have fatality figures in excess of that. So isn't it hard under the circumstances to wrest some sort of a racist theory out of what has happened in Vietnam?
First of all, the statistics that you've given that you just got from the Pentagon, I certainly am not familiar with. And certainly the statistics that have been released to the New York Times, I think to the right of New York Times magazine section about three Sundays ago, and certainly
yes.
to Mr. Muscovitz,
no,
I think.
But there are no discrepancies, because the Times figures were identical. But the Times gave only the figures for the Army.
Only
the figures for the Army. 14.7. 0.7% of the people in the army are Negroes, however, the Negroes registered 18.3% of the fatalities. That's the figure the New York Times gave.
18.3% of the fatalities.
In the army. But the composite figure, when you count the Navy and the Marines and the Air Force, gives you a figure of 14.6%.
Then that figure is reduced when you combine
the Navy,
which shows that there's a great amount of discrimination in the air services and the Navy.
You can't
services.
Win, can you?
No, I'm
you
saying that it's a matter of fact. Yeah. It's a matter of fact. Now, if you take the figure that's given by the Army, I'm assuming that those statistics are correct and they are up to date. My latest statistics show, and I'd be happy to give you my authority on this, it's one man who has made an extended study of the figures and the reasons why people have volunteered from the Army. I think an account of this was also given in I.F. Stone reports.
A fellow Wallaceite.
Well, I don't know whether he was or not.
Yes, he was.
Mm-hmm. Well, I find his figures to be extremely interesting. The figure goes up to about more than close to 35% of black soldiers in combat. Did you get that figure from the Pentagon?
Well, I got only figures on fatalities.
Only fatalities?
Yes, sir.
Well, now,
that's what you had talked about in the Times story.
Now, wouldn't you say that, wouldn't this raise a question to you on the basis of your figures, that since black people constitute 10% of the population as to why we constituted more than 18% of the casualties?
Well, not 18%, 14%.
Let's just say it's 14.6.
Although I think this may be fruitless, let's pursue that a little bit. In the first place, it's not 10%, is it? As I understand, the figures are that the Negro population now is over 12%. Now, is that wrong?
Well,
And that is less than the figures given by, for instance, Elijah Muhammad, who claims 25 million. Mm-hmm. So if it's 12 million, then 14% is within 1% of the expected average. But anyway, isn't there a sense in which, perhaps, one tends to neglect a couple of data, one of them I think very considerable emotional importance, and that is that people traditionally have been rather proud of the extent to which they have contributed to great patriotic efforts. Isn't that true? In New York, for instance, in South Carolina, in Pennsylvania, over the past 150 years, they always rush forward to say more Pennsylvanians than Ohioans gave their life for our country, and it interests me under the circumstances that something about which an awful lot of Negroes undoubtedly take extraordinary pride, i.e. their response to this particular national challenge, is something that you resent.
It's not a question of resenting or taking pride in one's country. It's a question of facing the fact, and I think the fact is the fact stands out before us that we get in the short end of democracy, and we are in a capitalistic system without capital. And these are just some basic facts that we are concerned with. We simply know that if we don't push for gains, our gains only come in a time of crisis.
Well, I don't think history really would completely back you on that, because there were many gains, I think a lot of people believe, during a period of relative tranquility. Booker T. Washington seemed to stress that point,
Upon, that's a subjective judgment.
Right.
When it regards how much progress was made during that period, that was the area of the great debate between Du Bois and Washington.
That's right.
About two conflicting philosophies, and those who were in Booker T's camp said Booker T accomplished a lot, and those who were in Du Bois' camp say that Du Bois.
And Du Bois went over and died a communist, practicing communist. And went over to Ghana, didn't he, to spend his last years, presumably his view of the relative superiority of Ghana under Nkrumah and the United States under Harry Truman is something that will give some people pause about.
Well, I don't know who Ghana is under. Do you really know whose Ghana is under now?
No, I say at the time that you both died. At the time that you both died.
Oh, well, regardless of crises this evening, gentlemen, our gains are being made by our audience tonight as this interesting discussion will continue in just a moment.
Mr. McKissick, I wonder really whether at the center of your resistance to the war in Vietnam isn't something really different from these completely negligible statistical irregularities, but something that has really to do with your wondering whether this country is worth fighting for, is this really your root difficulty in adjusting to the idea of Negroes and whites fighting side by side to defend American interests in Vietnam, the interests of the free world?
Well, I certainly think that a white man has much more to fight for than a black man. It's no question about it. When he comes back here, he's got everything. I remember my first day when I was in the military, I came back my first day back, I got slapped down. And that was in 41, and I remember I tried to get a job, and I had to take a job waiting tables on with the Southern dining car system because I couldn't get a job that I was qualified to do. And I
But
let me finish, because this is the crux of what we're talking about.
Yeah, that's
about.
What I think it is,
This is the crux of what we're talking about. You said so.
Yeah.
All right. So I think that the average black man loves this country. He loves it in spite of the wrong that he is forced to suffer.
Are you in that sense an average black man?
Well, I would think that I'm an average black man.
In that sense?
Yeah.
You love this country?
Yeah, I love it, but don't get the wrong impressions that
I'm... You want to qualify that.
I want to qualify my character of love. What I'm trying to say is that, and there are a whole lot of people who may say that I don't love the country, but I'm talking on terms of averages. And I would say that these things raise some very serious questions in the mind of people who are fighting. Now, I question the statistics that were given to you this morning by the Pentagon, because I'm very familiar with other people who have been unable to get the same statistics for many reasons. And I'm really amazed that you were able to give me these statistics that you have here this morning. And from the source that the last statistics came, and I do remember one Sunday morning we went to check on some dead bodies that came in the Brooklyn Naval Yard, and about 192 dead black soldiers came in and not a single white. And we were advised of these things. We have a little intelligence that brings information
they
to us.
They haven't integrated the undertakers.
It's quite possibly that they haven't done that.
That's a silly observation, if I may say so.
Well, you know, lots of things could be silly, you know.
Mm. No, let's stay on something that you think is so important, because I do too. The crux of the question, I want to hear from you, whether, in your judgment, the overwhelming majority of the Negro people who overwhelmingly do love this country, who have not protested the draft, who have not protested their own participation, whether or not you feel a contempt for them as a result of what you consider their inability sufficiently to recognize the shortcomings of this country.
Well, I don't know whether I can answer the question with all of the adjectives and conclusions, you know, embedded in the same. Let me answer it the way that I want to answer it.
Yes, sir.
All right. First of all, I think the average person, the average black man, loves the country like he loves a daddy that beats him when he isn't supposed to be beat, that won't support him, that runs off and mistreats his mother, but one that who lies to his child and everything, but one who he's forced to a great extent to love and admire because he has nothing else for a father but that kind of a father. And I think that's the position that most black people find themselves in.
Well, as you know, Mr. McKissick, I have for years agreed.
And if somebody attacks the father,
yes, that's right. They'll come to his rescue.
They'll come to his rescue.
But granted, as I think any sane man would have to do, granted the differences in what America offers and has offered to the white and to the Negro, which I think we must grant. Any sane, realistic man must grant. Still, I wonder whether
what is it that we must grant now?
We must grant that America offers far greater opportunities to white people. And has offered during the past more justice to white people than to Negro people. But the question that prompts me...
We get law, we don't get justice.
...to wonder... Well, now, wait a minute. Some of you get justice. You're very fond of these hyperboles, Mr. McKissick. One of my favorite. The greatest hypocrisy we have is the Statue of Liberty. We ought to break the young lady's legs and point her to Mississippi.
That's correct.
All right.
I'm famous for making that statement. In that case,
Miss McKissick, I'm glad to say that, so far as I'm able to judge, you are excluded from the overwhelming majority of the Negro people who have a great respect for the idealism of the Statue of Liberty and who know that a lot of people are doing everything in the world that they can precisely to redress these evils, precisely to realize the state of liberty that she stands
for.
And the one way to do it is not to break her back or to undermine the effort to fight for the free world in the South.
Well, let me ask you one simple, basic thing. Would you be opposed to sending registrars into the state of Mississippi?
Certainly not.
Why do murderers of black people walk the street down there?
Mr. McKissick, murderers of most people walk the streets.
Why can't we do something about it?
Something is being done about it. Something is not being done about it at a rate of speed sufficient to rehabilitate your faith in the principles of the Statue of Liberty.
How much do we need, 100 years?
I wonder whether there's another country in the whole bloody world that would concern itself in the way that the United States has done with the fate of an unfortunate minority. And yet you're talking about defaming one of the precious national symbols of this country. Now, I think under the circumstances that it is clear why the majority of the Negro leaders have repudiated your extremist views.
Oh, I don't think the majority of the people in the country have repudiated my views in the first place.
But
the same views that I had, I have been expressing over a period of years.
Yes.
I expressed these views throughout the South.
And what did you tell me a moment ago, before we came into the program, about Newsweek's rating of you, of your popularity among your own people?
I said that Newsweek had me down for a 19. Yeah,
along with Stokely Carmichael, with
along
Dr.
with
King
Stokely
is number one.
Carmine, Dr. King
therefore,
is
that
number
would
one.
Be that would be an objective, just an objective datum, so far as I can judge, of the extent to which your virulent anti-Americanism, as it sometimes surfaces,
your position on South Vietnam. I resent that now. See, because I think you jumped to conclusion. I've got to think the same way that you think, and yet our backgrounds are entirely different, and I'm not going to think the way that you think. And I'm going to disagree with you, and because I disagree with you, don't slap antis and throw general symbols and anti-symbols against me, and I'm anti-Statute of Liberty. I'm saying if you really believe in what that statute stands for, take it down there to some folks I know in North Carolina and Mississippi who don't know nothing about what it's about.
But maybe my obligation towards you is not to quote what you have said.
No, you can quote anything that I've said.
I am free to draw my own conclusions about what people feel about the United States who say that kind of thing about the Statue of Liberty. And all of your horror stories, and I know that they are horrible, are not sufficient, in my judgment, to justify your erratic posture as regards the United States and its symbols and the hopes of white people and black people alike. And what I'm saying here,
do you think
with reference to what you said, is
absolutely right in everything that it does?
No, it's not. It's not.
Huh?
It certainly isn't.
Well, all right, then. Haven't I got a right to say what I think is not right about it?
My dear Ms. McKissick, I have never voted for anybody who ever won an election anywhere in the whole world. So, obviously, I am, by pure democratic standards, far more underprivileged than you. At least you tend to vote for the person who wins, except for Henry Wallace.
I don't think that that's a valid comparison as to whether you ever voted for somebody that...
Well, certainly, because these people are passing laws all the time and handing down edicts who didn't have my support in the first instance. So obviously, I don't feel that the United States is obviously right. As I say, there would have been a greater correspondence between my voting for them and they having got in. However, I do love my country. And I suggest that the overwhelming majority of Negro people love this. I have in the infantry.
Yeah.
And I suggest the overwhelming majority of Negro people have given evidence that they love their country, and that for you to insist that to be truly engaged, to truly care about civil rights, requires that you are in favor of pulling out of South Vietnam, does, in my judgment, a tremendous disservice to your cause, because your cause of the civil rights is something which a lot of people want back.
We are going to continue with firing line with questions in just a moment. It is time for our question period on firing line. This first question addressed to Mr. McKissick. Mr. McKissick, do you feel that the black power concept will obliterate the advances and contributions that Negroes made before riots, demonstrations, and black power?
Gee, that's a question that you can't answer yes or no. The question really has to be answered by saying, first of all, and attempting to define what the Congress of Racial Equality means by black power. And I'll answer that by saying, first of all, we mean that black people have simply got to determine for themselves the rate of progress, the direction of that progress. And there are six basic ingredients to the accomplishment of black power. And black power is a direction through which you can obtain total equality. And those 6 points are as follows. One, black people have got to secure for themselves political power. Two, black people have to secure for themselves economic power. Three, black people have got to develop an improved self-image of themselves. And everybody always asks, what do you mean by that? I mean that the history books fail to record the fact that Dr. Charles Drew invented blood plasma, that the peanut was actually popularized and made famous by a black man, Dr. George Washington Carver, that black people first smelted iron in Africa, that Napoleon, for instance, was defeated by a black general named Toussaint Louverture in Haiti. All of these things relate to our image, that we do not know anything about ourselves, and they have purposely been left out of the history books. Leaving that particular point and going to point four, we'll have to develop militant leadership. And five, we seek enforcement of federal laws, the abolishment of police brutality, and the abolishment of police state tactics, as is in the South. And six, and last, and what we mean by black power, is the building and acquiring of a black consumer bloc, where we believe that while we can talk about one political power, that just as important is point six, the consumer power, because in reality, black people vote every time they put a dollar on the counter, because we're in an economic society, and if we do not have all basic ingredients that we have talked about, we'll never achieve the road to total equality.
Mr. Buckley, is there any comment you wish to make on that answer?
No, just just that I endorse all six of those objectives.
The next question is to you, Mr. Buckley. With the acceleration of civil rights bills passed by the Congress, the bitterness of the civil rights struggle, at least as measured by the number of riots and public disturbances, has nevertheless rapidly increased. What then, in your opinion, do you feel can be done, short of the drastic direct action which most of us deplore, to redress those legitimate Negro grievances?
Well, I think that's an awfully windy question. having endorsed the six objectives of Mr. McKissick, I would say that the prosecution of those objectives is what ought to be accomplished, is most definitely what ought to be done, with reference, however, to a constant and continuing respect for the rights of other people.
Mr. McKissick, at least one news reports that CORE will support those persons, and I don't think you denied this evening, that CORE will support those persons who refuse to serve in Vietnam. I wonder if you could spell that out for us. Precisely what sort of help will you give these people, and on what legal basis you'll do so?
It is on a legal basis that we are affording counsel for those persons who believe that their constitutional rights have been violated. I might add on that point that we believe that the two primary issues in the world today are peace and racism, that we should direct our struggle towards peace and we should direct our struggle towards the abolishment of racism. We believe that there are certain constitutional principles, legal constitutional principles, that can be evoked and that should be heard by a court to determine whether the law is a legal war, since it has not been declared a war by Congress, or whether we are violating the UN Charter, or whether we are violating the preamble of the UN Charter and its declarations. We also believe that these questions can be properly brought in a forum, and we have agreed to support those persons, and there are three such persons now that we have lent our support to.
Mr. Buckley, from your point of view, how would you account for, what shall I call, the growing disaffection of the most highly vocal civil rights groups, and I'm referring now to CORE and SNCC, and the white liberals for the most part, and how long do you think this disaffection might last?
Well, I don't know, but it seems to me clear that much of that disaffection comes from a conclusion that certain liberals have arrived at, that certain of these groups are moving away from nonviolent protest into violent protest, and that there has been a considerable tacit sanction given to vices, which are vices irrespective of whether they're committed by black people or white people or yellow people. That plus also a certain undertow of an inverted racism, which is detectable, for instance, in some of the plays of James Baldwin or Leroy Jones, which some liberals have not been able to see through, having been sickened by the experience of seeing all of a sudden grow out of that diseased part of the civil rights movement a distinctive kind of new racism.
Thank you, Mr. Buckley and Mr. McKissick, and we'll continue in just a moment.
Mr. McKissick, we only have a half minute to go, so I'll just take 2 seconds to say thank you very much for coming on the show, and I know you have something you want to close the show with.
Yes, I want to say the direction of the civil rights movement and direction towards black power is to divert the energies inward into the community. We've now moved our office up to 200 West 135th Street. We believe that we can accomplish much by work within the community. And the classic example of what can be done in a community, for that we point to Baltimore.
Thank you very much.